Hello, and welcome back to another Unfiltered Gamer board game review. Today's game up on the tabletop is Evil High Priest. With Evil High Priest, you'll be playing as an Evil High Priest, and you'll have your own slew of cultists that will be helping you throughout the game. Your objective? To free the Great Old One from his shackles, the Elder Signs. You'll be using blood, magic, treasure, and more in order to secure the Great Old One's place back into power. As you grow in favor with him and slowly decrease his shackles, you will then unleash his great, utter glory. Provided you have the most favor with him, you will then lead in world domination along with your Great Old One. As for the rest of the cultists and priests, those will be thrown into oblivion for their failure to service the Master. Alright, let's go ahead and take a look at the game Evil High Priest.
So, here is the game Evil High Priest, and everything included, except for the additional player boards and additional cultists, they're off to the side because this is a large game. But I'm going to go over everything, okay? So first of all, you're going to get one High Priest and two cultists in your cultist pool, and four of these cultists over here in the asylum. You're going to have an escape location where priests are going to go when you gather them, and you're also going to have this ability to gather one treasure if you want to place a cultist there as an action. There's your lair cards where you'll be placing monsters periodically throughout the game. You're going to also have the summon monster ability as long as you have no monsters in your pool. The rescue and occult provided you use your priest, which is basically going to allow you to gain a cult. This over here is chanting, which will allow you to gain these chambers. And of course your turn order, the gaming end, and the victory conditions, as well as the pay and earn symbols throughout the game. Over here is your chamber where you're going to be placing different chamber cards over here. We placed in this order from left to right, down, and then back down to the left area. This is your raid strength, which is bad. Basically, you're going to have investigators or inspectors that are going to come in and try and raid your sanctum and steal your treasure. This will be determining how strong they are. Over here is one of the many boards where you're going to be dealing with summoning one of the elder gods. This one here is Cthulhu, and it's going to have Shoggoth over here. There's a starting location, and these are all the elder signs which are going to be placed based on these little symbols here. Just place them on top of that. These guys are basically ready to go. They're fresh elder signs, but as you collect them, you're going to break them, which is going to show you the back symbol. Over here is the Deep One track, and it'll tell you on the board here when you open these spots up how to move this across the board. These will affect different specific play areas throughout the game. This is your towns area, which is going to be your main area for placing your cultists and your high priests, where you're going to gather different resources. It is where you're going to be spending your actions. There's a skulk area here and another for a 5-player only variant. This is going to be your monster stack, which is going to have in the base game regular monsters, and if you get the expansions, it'll have monsters with unique abilities. This is your chamber deck, which will have the different chambers right here. You place three of them to start off the game, and your investigator pool, which in the base game it does not have. However, if you get the expansions, you'll have your own investigator deck, and then of course the symbol, the numbers, which will determine which investigators are in which location and how they're going to spawn, which I'll talk about even though I don't have it. This is your ritual board, which basically after the first raid occurs, you're going to flip this over and you'll have new ritual locations and encounters that you can go ahead and attempt to complete. And that is mainly it. These over here are going to be your different currencies. You're going to have your treasure, you're going to have treasure, you're going to have magic, blood, and these over here are spells. You're going to have a first player token, which you can go ahead and gain, just like any other worker placement, by placing a cultist here. And then you're going to have some die, which will be used for the raid aspect of the game. There is, of course, additional boards in the game for each and every player. Up to 5 players can play the game, and you're going to have a lot of boards here, as you can see. These are all the additional cultists over here, and then you're also going to have these additional raid markers. But that is pretty much it we're going to be getting for the game, Evil High Priest. All right, let's come up and I'll tell you a turn of play and what you can do, and then I'll come back down here and show you how it's played. So beginning the game of Evil High Priest, you're going to be getting your main high priest and of course two cultists, and it's going to be pretty simple how it's going to work. You're going to be able to, on your turn, place one of your cultists or your high priest somewhere on the board and activate that specific board location and gain whatever currency that it provides. It's going to be magic, magic, it's going to be blood, it's going to be spells, so on and so forth. You'll be then using that currency to go on to other locations and spawning and gathering other different resources, where you're going to bring it back to your sanctum, and then you're going to utilize those by placing them somewhere in your sanctum. Now, you want to hide things in your sanctum, because if you don't, raids are going to occur throughout the game. Investigators are going to ponder their way in and try and steal all of your treasure, which is what you need to please the Old One. As you progress throughout the game, everybody is going to be placing in turn order their cultists and high priests until no one has any cultists or high priests left. Then after that, you're going to activate a skulk space, which is basically a space that allows you to place one of your characters on a space that has already been taken on the board. In a 1 to 4 player game, you can only place it in one space. In a 5 player game, you have 2 skulk spaces. At the end of the round, you're simply going to move your cultists on the ritual board, provided it is available. And the only way it's available is if there is a raid that has occurred. The first raid occurs, and then the cultist board will flip over, or the ritual board will flip over. Then you're going to simply return the cultist trapped either in the escape area or by monsters. Certain times you're going to have monsters that will take control of the cultists in the expansion. And then an escape is basically the place you're going to place your cultists after you've gained them, which are basically additional actions throughout the game. You're going to trigger any monster card effects. Then you're going to take all of your cultists back into the cultist pool and begin again. As you continue playing the game, you're going to unlock new locations and new spaces. You're going to gain elder signs, and eventually all of the elder signs will be taken. Once that happens, the game will instantly end, and the person who has the most treasure, or points in treasure, is going to win. There are different points for each of the treasures. The elder sign is worth 10. The purple ones here worth 2, I believe. And then you're going to have these guys worth 5. So they all have their own unique victory points. And whoever has the most at the end is the winner of the game. There's also rage, which I'll explain down below because it's a little more intricate, but that's the basic idea. It's a simple worker placement as far as that goes. And of course, it has some unique and interesting Cthulhu-like aspects to it. Anyway, let's go ahead and take a look at a turn of play, and I'll explain everything that can happen throughout the game. So now we're back again to Evil High Priest, and everything is set up for just one player, although you need to have at least 2 players to play. But for our example, we will only use just one. I'll have a second proxy character off to the side that will put down his units as well. To begin the game, simply choose one of these guys here and place them anywhere on the board that you'd like in these specific areas. Now, the first thing you need to know is that any of the blue circles around these specific treasures or the specific currency is going to be what you gain when you place a unit there. So for instance, in this location here, you're going to gain 3 treasure. In this location here, you'll gain 2 red, which are blood. This one is a treasure and a blood. This one over here is magic. And then this up here is going to be a cost. Anything with a red around it is going to have a cost. So you need to have 1 spell in order to place a guy here, in which case you're going to gain 1 of these, which is your chamber, and 1 of these, which is a monster. And you'll be placing it here and over here. And you'll be placing them in order with your chambers. This one over here is going to cost an elder sign, but it's going to give you 3 treasure. It's going to give you 2 blood and 1 spell. And it's going to give you an extra action meeple or cultist, provided that you have elder sign to spare. This is 1 of each. This is 10 of 1. And then these are any type. These white ones are basically any of these specific ones here. And this one here is going to give you the first player marker. The skulk location cannot be used for this though, and it'll also give you 1 treasure. Over here, like I said before, is chanting. And if you place your high priest here, it's the only character that can go here or here. You're going to gain 1 of these cards from here. It's these 3. When you take one of these guys and you place it down here, you're going to be able to put a new one down in its place. This here is going to cost you 2 treasure and 2 blood, but it'll allow you to gain a new cultist into this escape area for the next turn, which will give you more actions. And this over here will let you summon monsters. Only can be used after the first investigator raid, and only if you don't have any monsters in play. So it's a good way to sack a cultist, putting it in the asylum over here, and then you'll be able to gather a monster, okay? So those are the main locations, but there is up here, depending on the different types of gameplay, and you're going to always start at the start location or locations. If you wanted to go here, it's going to cost you 2 magic, and you could place it here. And if you did that, you'd gain the elder sign. You'd take this, you'd crack it, and you'd place it over there. So currency is always going to go either here or in a chamber location. And chamber locations are going to actually have a basically a quantity that you can put in there. This one says 2, this one says 1. It also has a trap value, which is 2, and this is 0. This one over here, you can only put the blood in, but you also get 3 damage as well. So you'll be trying to gather treasure and putting it in here to protect yourself from raids that are about to happen. As you progress through this track here, it's going to unlock new locations. So after you unlock a location, you'll have the option to go ahead and utilize the next space. So for instance, I would spend 2 spells here to gather an Elder Sign. I get to put it in my Sanctum, and then this would cost me 2 more blood, and I would gain a Cultist in my escape location, okay? So that's how you're going to be getting Cultists here, and of course on your board over here. Those are the main 2 ways. There are other ways, though, depending on the game scenario. Then, you're going to follow this track down along here. There's different arrows that will allow you to go different ways, and as you progress through it, you're going to gain new Elder Signs. There's, of course, costs among them, and bonus abilities. Once you've unlocked a certain location, like this one, and this one, these abilities can be used throughout the game, and you just have to pay the cost. In this one here, if it's unlocked, you'll be able to gain money equal to this specific Deep One track, and the Deep One track is going to increase based on how many of these are unlocked. So if you unlock this one, it says +1 to the Deep Run track, a Deep track, and if you would place a guy here, you gain 1. Anyway, that's the basic idea, right? It's a worker placement, but it allows you to progressively play farther down this track, and this one, of course, is also progressive. There's these 4 that you're going to start with, and then once you gain these, you're going to be able to purchase these locations and these ones as well. Okay, so that's the basic idea. We'll go ahead and start off. I will place 1 guy here on Kingsport. That will give me 3 treasure, which will go right here. This will go back to here. And then the next character or player is going to get to take their action. Maybe he'll take these 2 blood here, so he'll take 2 off of the board to his area. And then you'll get to go once again, and maybe you want Boston here, and that will net you 1 more currency and 1 more of these, and you'll place it in your area here. And then the next player is going to get to go. Maybe he'll place it over here, which will give him a magic. And then you're going to get to use your High Priest. Now, I would recommend, of course, to start off with chanting, because that's going to give you more Sanctum space. And I'm going to recommend probably this one here, the Vault. So you place the Vault here, and that says 2 damage to a investigator trying to enter here, kind of like the game Boss Monster. And you also can place 2 currency there. Whenever you place one of these guys here, you can place 2 currency to protect it. Sometimes it'll have specific requirements as to what you can place there. And, of course, anything that's left over is going to stay in here in the Exposed Resources. Anything in the Exposed Resources is dangerous, because that means that when you're being raided, this is the first thing to go. It's the first line of defense after the monsters, so you got to be very, very careful. After that, then, the next cultist will get to place down. He can put down on maybe the Skulk here, and then basically after that, that will end the turn phase for every player, except he will get to take 1 last action, and he can place his guy on any location that has already been previously played upon. So he could place that there, and he'd gain 3 more currency. And then after that, all of these will get refreshed. You're going to gain all of your cultists, and they will all go back here, and all of these guys are going to go back to your opponent. And, of course, any guy in your escape location is going to come into your cultist pool. So it's a way of gaining more and more actions as the game progresses. Now, as you can see here, you want 2 of these purples, because that's going to net you the ability to break this Elder Sign and gain you an easier way to gain new units as well. So the next turn is going to start up once again, and players are going to start placing. Now, remember this first player marker? If it's on this player here, it's going to stay on that player until somebody goes here and takes that first player marker away. So he's going to get to go once again. So maybe he's going to go here to this Innsmouth place. He's going to score 2 more red, which will go there. The next player will get to go and play something and take something as well. And then this red player is going to get to do something interesting. So he's going to go ahead and place the Rescue and Occult. He would spend 2 green here and 2 red, and that is going to net him an Occult. Cultist, and he gets to put it in his escape location from his asylum. So the next turn, this is going to come into play, and he's going to have an extra action. Super good, right? Another interesting thing, too, is if this player here actually played on, let's see what he wants to do. If he wanted to play it right here, right, and he had these 2 purples, he would spend those, he'd crack this, he'd gain this, and he would be able to have this extra option to spend 2 red, which he will also do. And that will net him another cultist. So he would take 1 of them from out of the pool and place it onto his board as well. And then this would be available for the next player as well. So if I had two red, I would be able to place it here, but not if a unit is here and not if there is 1 here. So that also opens this track up here. So these now are spells that you can gather, depending on if you can gain them, which are over here, 1 of each type or 10 of the gold currency. And then over here is the different two spells here. So that is how the game is going to progress down the track. And that's the basic idea. Now let's talk about something that's interesting, okay? How about we talk about raids? Here's how raids work. So let's say, for instance, we'll go ahead and take all the characters back now, bring our escapees up. We didn't have anybody on the skulk, so these all move here. And then let's say that we wanted to gain one of these here. So let's say that this character actually had one of these and it was in his exposed resources. He would move his character over here, which would then net him an Elder Sign. He would take this and put it over here. And then he would get to push plus one on the deep track. So it would go up one. And then there's this gun. Now, one gun means one die, two guns means two, and three means three die. You're going to be utilizing these die. So what will happen is you'll be rolling this die here. And depending on the number, this is a three, it's going to have an investigator, which would normally actually have this one of these guys here go. But because there's no investigators here for this for the expansion, I don't have that. But normally you would determine the investigator by rolling a die. So if it was a, let's say it was a three, this investigator would be active. Then you'd roll the other die to basically determine the raid strength, which in this case it would be a three. After that, you would go ahead and set the raid strength, like what I just did. Check your defense. So right now, I don't have any monsters. But if I did, let's say I had a monster here, I could sacrifice that monster into the discard pile over here. A new monster would pop out. And they're all the same. So, and that would be five, which would protect me from that three. So it would go down to zero. Now, if I didn't have that monster, though, which I didn't, we would check here. And that would destroy everything in this space here, because there's no defenses here. It would move on to here, and it would take two damage, one and two, leaving me with one, and it would then destroy these as well. So I'd lose all my resources if I chose to do a raid right now, or somebody else chose to do one on me, and that's no good. You don't want that to happen, but it might happen, right? So you want to be well prepared. So instead, let's say I have this over here, then in that case, it would maybe look something like this. So the monster would come through, it would take two damage, and it would go to one, and then this would get sacked, all of these would burn as well. And it would get to this, it would take three more damage, go to zero, and this would be saved. So this stuff protects your resources. That's kind of how it works, and you'd build it along this line here. So that is the basic idea of raiding. There's other ways you can prevent yourself from losing currency, and that way is basically by sacrificing any cultist on the board from anywhere, putting it into the asylum. That will take down a difficulty rating by two, and thusly reducing the potential for you to lose resources. So it kind of gives you the option, do you want to lose actions, or do you want to lose resources for what happened during the raid? And it gets more difficult as you go down the track. You know, like I said, two dice and three dice can be a lot more difficult to keep your items. Certain of the different chambers are going to have different requirements. Some of them, like this one here, says if there's an Elder Sign or a spell on this location, then this is going to be worth four. Otherwise, it's worth zero, and it also protects one treasure. And so you'd be building. Another interesting thing, too, is if you built everything here, you can then, on your next build, remove anything you want and place a new one down, and thusly place your resources on there. And at the end of every turn, you can move your resources around as well. The only time you can't is at when the raid starts. So whenever you place anything down, you can place it down anywhere you want in here, provided you have the Sanctum cards there. And then if there is all filled, you can replace them. So that's how that works. Now, other than the raid, there's another interesting aspect, which is the rituals over here. And that will flip over when the first raid occurs, and thusly giving you more actions. Now, how do these work? Because they're different than these. You don't simply place it down and gain the resource. What you do is you place a character, a cultist or the high priest down on one of these five locations. You spend the resources, so it would cost two green. And then after that, at the end of the turn, you'll move this guy over just before you do the skulk, and you'll collect resources based on whatever it is. But you do not return. You only return at the end. After you collect, you'll return on the next turn. So it's going to be one additional turn here. In this case, at the end of the turn, you move here. At the end of the next turn, you move here and collect the resources. Then you'll move and collect the resources here, and then you'll take it off. So that's why you can get a lot of money here, 18 in total. But if I placed it right here at the end of the turn, I'd just simply move it over here. I'd gain this, and then I would have to wait until the end of next turn to get my cultists back into the pool. So this ritual space opens up more options, makes some better choices too, but at the cost of time and losing your actions. There's Shoggoth over here, which basically says you can gain control of Shoggoth by gaining this space here. And you could also lose control of it with this one here for a specific reason. Otherwise, though, it's basically going to give you 10 defense value, which is really nice. But that's the basic idea of the game. Once all of these elder signs have been cracked and placed on the boards, you're going to then tally up all the points remaining. Even if the last one was a raid, it wouldn't matter. You wouldn't do the raid. So once all of these get cleared, that's the end. Count up all the points, and the points are down here. It tells you 10 points for an elder sign, 5 for a spell, 2 for magic, 1 for blood, 0 points for these, for the cultists, I believe is what it is, or the monsters, and then 0 points for the cultists. This one over here, though, the treasure, whoever has the most treasure at the end of the game is going to score 5 points, and no, everybody else gets nothing. And whoever has the most points is the winner of the game, Evil High Priest. And like I said, there's a bunch of expansions like that, such as the investigators that I do not have, unfortunately, and the priest cards, which I also don't have. But just for the base game, that is how you play it. All right, let me tell you what I think about it. So, caveats for Evil High Priest. Now, the first thing is, when you're placing down these chambers here, you're going to be able to rearrange your resources once you place them down. So if you want to switch things up, you can do that. You can also switch things up at the end of your turn. And whenever you gather a resource, you can place it on your board, provided you have a space for it. Everything else, or if there's no room, is going to go into the exposed resources, which is the first thing you're going to lose. And when monsters go through, or investigators go through your sanctum to try and destroy your stuff, you're always going to have them take damage from the location first, provided there is damage, and then they're going to take all of the treasure if they do not die from that location first. So you're not going to simply, if they have 1 health and there's a trap that's next that's 3, they're going to go to 0 and they won't be able to take the treasure on that location. And that is pretty much it. I think I explained pretty much everything. Like I said, there's a lot of point value in these elder signs, and you can utilize the raid spaces to your benefit. So you can try and force force your fellow cultists to suffer from investigator raids. And there is product I don't have that is interesting, because it's all in the rule book as for all the expansions and whatnot. It shows you whatever, where everything is and what you would get if you had those expansions. Because I don't, it's just kind of empty space. But nevertheless, that's how you play. So what do I think about the game now? Okay. Well, I love Caverna. Caverna is a really cool worker placement game. I think most people enjoy it. It has a few fiddly things with it involving adventurers. But this game reminds me of Caverna. It is a worker placement. You are basically trying to summon the deep old ones, and you're working against your allies, other cultists trying to summon the evil old gods, right? And as far as that works, the theme is awesome. I love that aspect of the game. I really like Cthulhu. I really like Peterson Games. Everything I've played from them is really, really good so far. I even liked Orcs Must Die. I thought that was a really fun game. So, you are going to be making sanctums, right? Instead of a farm, or instead of something else like Agricola, you're going to be making a sanctum in which gets raided. And that is the only amount of, I guess, luck that you would see in the game, because you're going to roll the die and determine how much difficulty the investigator is, how much of a pain in the butt the investigator is going to be. And that can really make you suffer, especially if you're attempting to hurt your opponent. You can fell swoop them and destroy them, and that will make them want to be done. So I can see somebody going, okay, you destroyed my entire sanctum, it's over, especially in a 2-player game, right? In a bigger player game, it might not be as bad. So my first tip is, protect your treasure. It's the most important thing in the game. Doing other stuff is important. Getting actions and whatnot is great, but if you don't have a protection for your treasure, you're in deep doo-doo. The artwork for this game is spectacular. I enjoy everything about the artwork. The quality of the components is nice. It has a huge footprint. So you have to have a large table, especially if you're playing with more than 2 players. This game took up almost my entire table with just 2 players. So be aware that Peterson Games generally has large games, and even the meeples are large in this game and in charge. As far as the worker placement goes, this is an excellent game. I would recommend this just as much as I would recommend Caverna. And I don't think there's anything fiddly with this game, other than the fact that if you roll the die and you get unlucky by either rolling too low and not hurting your opponents, or rolling too high and destroying your opponents, that would probably be the only thing. If I'm going to be nitpicking now, I love the game as it is, but it has monsters in it, right? And they're all 5s. Every single one of these monsters is the same monster. And they has an expansion that will include different unique monsters. And I almost say it's a must get, because the monsters are just kind of whatever. They all look the same. They have no abilities. And I want to see that. I want more content. This game has a ton of content as it is in the base game. But for some reason, seeing the monsters, I'm like, oh, I gotta pick up a monster. I'm like, it's really useful, but they're all the same. Everybody's going to have the same one. I don't know why, it just threw me off. And also doesn't have investigators. So you don't get to roll the die to determine what investigator is going to come and raid you. And so you can't prepare for them because they just don't exist unless you have that expansion. There is one specific expansion for this game that has both of those things. And I highly suggest you get it. I don't know how it will play with it, but it just sounds so much... It's going to be even more interesting aspects to the game. It will change that we can bribe some investigators to not come in and raid you. It has some really cool aspects to it, and I really like that idea of it. I went through the entire rulebook and read all of the expansion stuff, even though I don't own them. And I must say that I really, really want them, because I think the game would be even better. There's more boards to this game. Cthulhu is great, and on the back of the board is actually the black goat, and it plays very differently, too. On this one here, it's more about raiding. There's tons of raid stuff, but you also get a ton of monsters on the board, and that is awesome as well. Opening up the game to include the rituals after the first raid is a really good idea, because it makes it very simple to start with, and the game gets more complex, more choices, more options everywhere, and as you get through it, you start to understand. So even as your first play, you go, oh, okay, now I understand this aspect of the game. Oh, now there's raids. That's cool. Okay, I understand how a raid works. Oh, now there's rituals. I understand how the rituals work. And then before you know it, the entire board is open and available for you to get whatever you want. And now it's about how you want to destroy your opponent, how you want to gather as much treasure, and how you want to protect your chamber. It works. It's fun. I really, really enjoy this game. This is definitely one of my top five favorite worker placements after playing this. I only wish, like I said, that I had the extra expansion stuff, because I feel like those things are almost needed in the game, because it's actually part of the boards that you get. So it actually has investigator spots on it, but you don't have any. That's my only sadness. I mean, it's such a minute gripe, right? Like, I want more game, even though there's a ton of game already here. Anyway, overall, the game is excellent. I really, really like this game, and I'm probably going to personally pick up the expansion just because I enjoy it so much. In my ending, I rate this game seal of approval. Definitely go ahead and check out the game Evil High Priest. I strongly recommend it.